This conference will now be recorded.
Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to today's pre-conference grantee session, Increasing the Quality or Quantity of NAMRS Submissions. Today's presenter will be Carl Urban, Senior Research Manager with WRMA. Before we get started, I want to say really quickly, this meeting is being hosted on a GoToMeeting format, which means that participants are not muted. We're going to ask that everyone ensure their mics are muted so that mics are muted so that we can ensure minimal background noise. Also, we are going to ask that people not use their webcams during the presentation unless Carl chooses to do so as the presenter. That way we can minimize any distractions during the meeting as well. Next slide, please. The National Adult Maltreatment Reporting System, NAMRS, and the Adult Protective Services Technical Assistance Resource Center, the APS TARC, are a project of the U.S. Administration for Community Living, Administration on Aging, Department of Health and Human Services, administered by the WRMA Incorporated. Contractors' findings, conclusions, and points of view do not necessarily represent the official policy of the U.S. government. At this time, I'd like to turn it over to my colleague, Carl Urban. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everybody. I think I'm going to go cameraless this afternoon. I think all of you know what I look like, and so we all would probably agree that is best. Unless you want to see my puppy dog who just walked in here. It's good to be with you guys this afternoon. This is a workshop on NAMRS. As I sit here and scroll through the attendee list, I see that some of you went to this very same workshop last year when we did it. And I see that many of you could probably give the presentation on NAMRS, on the NAMRS part of this. So, The main thing that we are trying to do with this particular workshop is to focus some on the requirement that was a part of your grant for increasing quality and quantity of NAMRS submissions. And mainly we just want to talk about how you're doing it, share information, learn from each other, maybe identify what some of your barriers are and what we can do to help you get around the barriers. It is not much more complicated than that. So I'm going to talk a little bit about NAMRS to start, and then we're just going to move into some very specific discussion questions. And we would like to have your participation. So when we get to these questions, we would like to have someone from every state provide a response. And Leslie, I don't know if we want to call out specific states or if we want to freeform and just track and make sure that we've got it done. Do you have any particular thoughts on that? You and I have not discussed that yet.
No, I guess we can just track what we get as we get it and go from there.
All right, we will do that. Leslie will be in charge of quality assurance to make sure everybody participates. So that is our game plan for today. So NAMRS, when we're talking about NAMRS, what are we talking about? So I bet all of you have seen this slide before, National Adult Maltreatment Reporting System. It's a system in which we are trying to collect at the national level state-specific data that is as an accurate representation of what is going on in APS programs around the country as possible. We want to know and understand about the nature of exploitation and abuse of older adults and adults with disabilities as reported to state APS agencies. As you know, NAMRS is a voluntary reporting system, and as you know, there is quite a diversity and to some extent a disparity in those systems that exist out there in the states. So the idea behind NAMRS is to establish kind of a national standard that we can all move towards in terms of what data we think is important for APS and begin collecting that data. And over time, moving to a place where we really have a much better understanding of the system. And why is that important? Because as it says here, ultimately our goal is to improve APS services and to improve outcomes for our clients. Before NAMRS was established, there was not any way to really get a handle on what state APS systems look like relative to one another. So with the agency component data that we now collect with NAMRS, we have a pretty good understanding. We know exactly what types of maltreatment are investigated. We know how many reports of maltreatment are investigated. And it just tells us things about the system that we did not know before. Kathleen Quinn, who used to be the executive director of NAPSA back when NAMRS was being developed, used to say, and she still, I'll still hear her say it from on occasion, she'll say, no data, no dollars. And that's the second point there, is that this better understanding of our system is going to give us information so that we can advocate, so that we have the data that we need to make the case for more resources and improvement. I was literally on the phone 10 minutes ago with a state doing my NAMRS liaison duties, and we were talking about the fact that they were in the process of implementing structured decision-making tools, and they were going to be collecting all of this information about the risk needs of their clients. And she said, the conundrum for us is we're going to be collecting this information about needs of our clients. We really don't have a lot of money for services, but the second half of the sentence is, but we think collecting the data will help us get to a place where we can make the case for services better than we have in the past. We have used NAMRS data for a lot of research and evaluation work, some of which you have seen, some of which you have not seen. I think you probably have attended at the last year's NAPSA conference, the workshop that we did on evaluation. If you did not, I encourage you to go to the workshop at this year's NAPSA conference on outcomes that WRMA and New Editions are doing together, and you will see some charts that pull data straight out of NAMRS and do some comparisons to help us think about what is going on in terms of systems or process outcomes in the world of APS. Another workshop that's going to be at this year's conference is going to talk about the work that we have done using NAMRS data in predictive analytics. Really exciting stuff, really kind of groundbreaking stuff. Again, all geared towards that, helping us to understand the system so that we can do a better job for our clients. The last area is best practice and service innovation. You know, we as a technical assistance resource center get questions all the time about what state is doing this, how is this going, and NAMRS becomes one of those resources that we really look to help us define and understand what are the consistent practices across the states. So as states are trying to improve themselves, we have a data resource that's available to help us with the TA and to help us define what is best practice in service innovation. So how does it in the long run benefit states? Apologize for Lacey barking there. The first thing NAMRS did was when it was put together, a large group of stakeholders and experts were pulled together, and they were asked the question, if we want to understand state APS systems, what data do we need to collect to do that? And what they came up with was all of the data elements that you see in NAMRS. And so the consequence of that is that you have got a definition of what data is important to APS programs built, put together based on expert opinion. So if you want to know a place to start assessing yourself, evaluating yourself, that NAMRS framework is a great place to start. And then if you want to move on down the road in terms of your own self-examination and your own improvement, NAMRS gives you a portal to a number of things to help you improve. The data reports in there can help you better understand your own program, particularly if you're doing comparisons with like states. One of the things, and this is what we're going to talk about in a minute, one of the things that NAMRS has done is it has prompted states to improve their data collection systems. You're able to add data elements to be consistent with NAMRS. As you're looking at the data before you report it to us, you're looking at your data more carefully than you have before. So you're identifying gaps and you're identifying inaccuracies, you're identifying inconsistencies, and you're improving your data for your own internal purposes. And then, you know, the long-term plan, and we've talked some about this with you from an ACL perspective, is to move to a much broader set of data use agreements to where we are sharing state-specific data so that you can start doing some of those very targeted comparisons, some of those benchmarking kinds of projects that are going to help you identify your areas of program improvement. So for example, say you've got a concern with how you're defining and investigating financial exploitation. Well, we can pool data for you on financial exploitation for states that have a similar sort of definition. And you can start digging into things to try to better understand how to improve your program. The data will give you a means to target your areas of improvement and information by which to make those improvements. So where are we? In 2019, this is a chart we pulled out in 2019 adult maltreatment report. 32% of the states provided agency and key indicator information. 59% of the states provided agency and case information, and 9% of the states, and I should say states and territories as well as the District of Columbia, provided only the agency information. So you see by far, the majority is states that are able to provide us the case component, the client specific information. I anticipate we will add 2 or 3 states this year. We are continually encouraging that and trying to provide the resources and the support that are necessary to help the states to get there, because the more granular of information that we can get, the easier it is for us to fulfill these benefits for you. So we are continuing to push states to be able to provide us with case component information. So I'm not going to read all the data on this chart. This chart comes straight out of the 2019 adult maltreatment report, but It's the one picture example that I can think of that says, what does the system of APS services look like across the country? And so you've got it here in one chart. You've got 1.3 million reports of alleged maltreatment received by APS programs, of which 38% were screened out. The rest were investigated. And then you can see the breakdowns by the types of professionals that were submitting the data. You can see it by type of allegation. For example, one of the things we now know about APS that we didn't know before, self-neglect cases are over half of the cases that APS programs investigate. We come to understand through this data how many clients there were, how many victims there were, how many cases were there with substantiated allegations in them. And then we learn a little bit about services as well through this process. One thing that we did this past year, and this will be new information, I think, for most of you, is we did a gap analysis. ACL asked us to do a gap analysis. And basically, what we did was we went in and we looked at every data element in every state and try to assess the completeness of the data and try to get some sense of the accuracy of the data that we were getting. And so we looked at 5 different factors as we were conducting this analysis. And this slide kind of summarizes what we found from that. The big box at the top is what I talked about on the previous slide, which is that the number of states providing case component data is increasing slowly, almost up to 2/3. The other five factors that we looked at were, first, timeliness. Last year was a little rougher than previous years in terms of timeliness. We've never really had a timeliness problem with NAMRS data. You know, occasionally we'll get a state or two that'll run into an XML problem at the very end they didn't anticipate or something like that and may need a couple of day extension. But generally we get the data on time at the end of March. Completeness. Now, completeness is really complicated. And you have to remember that NAMRS was built with a lot of aspirational data elements in mind, back to that group of experts saying, what do we want to know? What we want to know is not necessarily what we do know. And so what we found when we did the completeness analysis with those is that there is significant variation across states and across the data elements. So when you think about it from a state perspective, no state, I think it's accurate to say that no state provides all of the data elements. And really few states provide most of the data elements. And so when we looked at the states that were providing a lot of the data elements, those states had a lot of unknowns in their data or a lot of missing data. So while they may have been collecting data on perpetrator kinship relationship, it wasn't being documented in a lot of cases. So those states that were collecting a lot of data elements had a lot of unknowns. Conversely, what we found was that those states that weren't reporting as many data elements did not have as much unknown. So you have this tension out there between trying to collect a broad set of data and having a lot of missing data versus being very focused but having a better set of data. So that was one of the clear insights that we gained from this as we looked at the states. When we looked at it at the data element level, what we discovered is that demographic data elements have very complete data. Age, sex, gender, type information is very good. Disability, not so much, but those core demographic data elements have very good data. After that, it really can go downhill in a hurry in terms of overall completeness, where you'll have completeness levels in the high 90s for the demographic elements. Depending on the data element, it can go down all the way to almost no states are reporting certain types of data elements. When we looked at it at the case component level, we discovered that information was much better collected on client and victim data than it was on perpetrator and perpetrator relationship data. That, when you think about it, is really not very surprising. We also tried to look at consistency and accuracy of the data. NAMRS has a number of things built into the system to try to help us look at consistency and accuracy. And so at some level, we have some ranges and some edit and some validation rules, edit checks and validation rules to help us look at data. But this is an area, I think, for big improvement for APS data, because we're just sort of scratching the surface when it comes to looking at data consistency and data accuracy. It's never been, other than this high level stuff that we do as part of our submission process, never been a big focus of ours. It may be something that we try to focus on a little bit more as we move forward, keeping in mind that there's a lot of aspirational data elements in the system and that it is a voluntary system. You don't have to dig real hard into the data, though, before you find things that just look weird from time to time. And it's usually kind of after the submission process when we're looking at the data. So this is a frontier for a lot of potential improvement for us going forward. Then the last thing is the question of representativeness. And so we've got almost 2/3 of the states providing information on case component data. Do those 2/3 of the states represent the nation as a whole is kind of the question. And the answer to that is It's really hard to tell. So we've got 85% of the 52 states submitted data overall, and they actually account for 72% of the APS eligible population in the United States. So in that sense, it's pretty good representativeness of this very kind of broad metric. But when you start digging down into the data elements themselves, and it's the data that we're getting representative of the nation as a whole, particularly for the case component states, it gets to be a really tricky statistical thing to try to figure out. So representative at some very broad levels, yes, but once you get beyond that, you have to be careful with how the data is actually used. So we want to switch from talking about what NAMRS is, how we're using it, what's going on with NAMRS, to, okay, you guys have got your grants and you've got your grant requirements that say, as part of the grant requirements, we're going to help you get to a place where we fill in some of those gaps in terms of completeness. We're going to get to a place where we're actually collecting more accurate data. And so ACL has written this into their grant requirements the last several years. And so you see here on this slide, the purpose statement for ACL's state grants to enhance adult protective services. The first part is about improving that system, the same goal that I was talking about in terms of how NAMRS data is used. But when you get down to the end of it, you see this very specific language that says, with this funding, states will also review the capacity of their current APS information systems and determine how they can improve the quality and quantity of data reported to NAMRS. So for the last several years, as part of their grants, knowing how important data is to improve the overall system, they've wanted states to focus in on reviewing their capacity within their systems and determining how to improve that quality and quantity of data. And that's the question that we're going to turn around and ask you in just a second is, okay, in your state for your grant, exactly how are you doing that? There's also language in there that is a little bit more specific in terms of the actual requirements. What's the goal that you're trying to achieve with that? And so you see in number two there, the goal here is improvements in the state's ability to document and report APS case, client, and perpetrator characteristics and services in a manner that is consistent with the National Adult Maltreatment Reporting System. Remember, I said that one of the goals, one of the benefits of NAMRS is it provides a framework for thinking about what is important in APS. And so within the context of your grant, we want you to be applying that framework, to be thinking about how does my grant help improve the services in my state, and we're going to use a NAMRS framework to try to think about that. And at the same time, we're going to be contributing more data to help us understand that framework and that system at the national level through what we submit. So that's the ACL grant requirements. So here's the first discussion question, and we've got a series of three questions here. And the first question is, please describe how you plan to meet the ACL grant requirements related to NAMRS. And so if I could have someone from each state give like a 2-minute description of exactly what your grant is doing, which I realize may be a little bit redundant in terms of meetings past, but it helps set the context for then talking about exactly what you are doing to increase that quality and that quantity, what you are doing in terms of your state's improvement in its ability to document and report APS case information. And so just so that we don't have complete silence here, and since they are ranked number one in the country and first almost in the alphabet, I think I saw Alabama here. Alabama, you want to go first? I think I saw Alabama. Am I right, Leslie? Or am I not?
Yes, I think Alabama's here.
Alabama's in the house. Would y'all mind going first answering this question?
Hey, hello everyone, this is Tanya. How do we plan to meet the ACO grant requirements related to NAMRS? We have we really have met a lot of our requirements related to NAMRS. I can hear myself talking.
So let me state, I should say before I put them on the spot, when we did a chart of all of the states and how many data elements they submit, Alabama's at the top. So Alabama's got, in some sense, less room for improvement than other states. With that, go ahead.
Yeah, so right now we are just building off of what we currently have as far as the name of data elements that we have identified.
Do you recall what you said in your grant response you were going to do in terms of NAMRS improvements?
Carl, I wasn't prepared to discuss that. If you'll give me, if you'll go to someone else and then come back to Alabama, I'll be glad to be able to speak more intelligently about this.
All right, we will circle back.
Thank you.
No problem. With another state like to go.
Yeah, sure. This is Kathy from Arizona.
Oh, you can go, Kathy.
Great, only because I need to jump off here in a minute. So with our grant, it's a three-year grant, and we had started with our current systems do not talk to each other in regards to services at the start. So we had created a data layer to create to basically create a master customer data layer, if you will. When we started this, we were at, apologize, I think it was 42 data elements. With the data layer, we went up to 48. And now we're in the process of replacing our APS case management system, which will be 100% compliant with NAMRS. We have some policy and procedures that we're going to have to work through, because right now some of those elements that are requested through NAMRS are not part of the state's, I'll say, policy and process, if you will, but we are looking at that. So we're on this journey, this IT journey, to help bring us up to, I'd like to say 100% compliance, but that might take another year or two, but we are it's really about the IT. It's about the system and being able to capture the data.
Okay, that is a great explanation. I do have to jump in and say, from an ACL perspective, there is no such thing as a compliant, quote unquote, system. All of your data elements will be consistent with NAMRS.
There you go. Okay.
There, but one we often emphasize since it's a voluntary system.
Yep, I knew that. Sorry, wrong.
No problem. Who wants to go next?
Hey, Carl, it's Amber Moore in West Virginia. So, West Virginia.
Go ahead.
Hello, can you hear me? Okay.
Yes.
So, we currently just do agency component data. So, we're really going to make some massive improvements with our reporting. What we do have a database that we work out of, but our reports are lacking to say the least. And so what we've done is worked on a monthly management report for our supervisors to do hand counts for all the information for key indicators data. So that's the big focus on our grant. In other news, we are working on a new computer system, and I've requested reports to do case component data years down the road. So we're really improving here in our state.
That sounds great. Michael, you turned your video on. Is that because you want to go next?
Sure, thank you. yeah, just to try to get your attention there. So in that questionnaire, what are we doing to meet our ACL grant? Here in Montana, we've set up a new database system, replace our old one. and set the parameters not only to address what we feel are our needs and what we need to track, but taking in the NAMRS from the pilot project and moving forward, what those elements look like, and to be able to track those. In addition to that, then we have expanded to be able to bring in our other state counterparts with the State Unit on Aging, the area agency programs, our community services-based programs, as well as moved it in to bring in on the what we call the certification licensure of nursing homes, et cetera, where everyone now can report into this so we can get a better central understanding of the abuse, neglect, and exploitation going on in our state. And this last part of our year this year is to now encompass our Attorney General's Office, the Consumer Protection Bureau, along with several of the other entities in law enforcement to get the reports to us so we can have a better understanding of the abuse, neglect going on in the state and what the outcomes are.
Okay. Who'd like to go next?
How about Oklahoma?
How about Oklahoma? Neighbor to the north.
Yeah, you got it. This is Kathy Wood. And one of the primary things that we were looking at to do with the grant is adding inconclusive to our maltreatment dispositions. Before, we only had substantiated or unsubstantiated for investigations. So we have had to add the inconclusive disposition to our policy. And then we have it in our system, but we're not using it yet. We have to wait until the policy gets approved. We are also doing some things with our service planning to include some more data points that NAMRS has in your service categories, and including benefits to where we would have more information on Medicaid and other public benefits that are received by clients. And also recidivism, to have a better tracking device for recidivism rates. And we also have gone to a new computer system that is not anything that was a part of the grant that came later. So we have just moved over to a new system in July, and we believe we'll be able to get some really good data and reporting from our new system in the future.
That sounds great. Who would like to go next?
Carl, this is Margie.
Hi, Carl.
Whoever started first there.
So I added my.
Would you mind introducing yourself again? We did got kind of talked over.
This is Margie from Minnesota. I added my information in the chat that we will be reviewing the previous case component submissions to increase our data elements. What we did find is the current information that we collect in the new AP data warehouse, it comes from the current forms that we use. So in order to increase our NAMRS submission, we need to change our options in our forms. So you're only as good as the data that is actually submitted. So we are working on getting gender fields added, but it will not be ready until probably the submission for 21 will be changing from gender fields to gender identity, and also additional race and ethnicity options for our maltreatment reports.
Okay. Who'd like to go next?
Hi, Carl. This is Tracy from Utah.
Hey, Tracy.
Long time no talk. since we just had a meeting with you yesterday. So we are using, I realize everybody else doesn't know this. Carl knows this because we just met with him yesterday, but we have been evaluating what data we're lacking on based on our recent report data that just got pulled for the last fiscal year, our federal fiscal year. And so we're looking at, we need to indicate we need to improve our perpetrator data. And so that is one of our target areas. We also have used some of the grant funding to build enhancements in our database. So we'll be using the service plans enhancement that we have available to us, which will be able to track services referred and services accepted. And then one of the things our database currently doesn't have is a way to track ADLs and IADLs. So we have built an assessment, and we are going to be utilizing that assessment tool where our database folks will be able to pull NAMRS reporting data on ADLs and IADLs. And then we also, while this NAMRS doesn't require this, one of the things that we added as well as part of our grant money, so I'm going off on a little bit of a tangent here, is we wanted to be able to understand the cost of exploitation in Utah, what's being reported versus what we can support on our cases. And so we have added fields in all of our intake, online reporting, and in our investigation fields to capture the cost of exploitation. So we're really excited in this next year. Everything is just getting activated. So we're excited to see what that produces as well.
That all sounds great. Who else would like to go?
Hey, Carl, this is Heidi Cresta from Massachusetts.
Hi, Heidi. Long time as well.
You can all probably tell from my accent that it's Heidi from Massachusetts. So our project, we've actually rebuilt our database from the ground up, completely from scratch. We had a very old database that was not relational. We had multiple databases that weren't necessarily speaking to each other. So we've completely built a new database and greatly enhanced the number of data elements that we will be tracking and capturing. And hopefully for our submission for the next fiscal year, we will be able to submit case component data. I think, you know, we're not really talking about challenges, but one of the challenges, or several of the challenges for Massachusetts, are that we have to combine our data with our sister agency, and our definitions and jurisdictions are very, very different. So that's the biggest challenge for us. We have to, up until now, we've been doing manual compilation of the numbers and combining them in order to submit our data from the state of Massachusetts. And a lot of the data we just, DPPC doesn't have the ability to capture. We have no jurisdiction over financial abuse. We have no jurisdiction over self-neglect, self-abuse cases. And we are not a service providing agency. So we're kind of an unusual agency in our jurisdiction and our regulations. So it can be challenging for us, but we're excited because we've greatly increased the number of data elements that we have already started to collect as of October 1st.
And you somewhat anticipated my next question regarding barriers, but that's okay. So I see in the chat, Jody from Illinois says she seems to be having trouble with her audio. And so she said that they've discussed how their enhanced training, simulation training as part of the grant, APS, caseworkers and supervisors are expected to improve the quality of the data collection and analysis during their assessments. So experienced active listening along with increased caseworker awareness, competence, and confidence all lead to more effective communications with the clients, which allows the caseworker to fully engage with asking questions to understand the client situation while also increasing the accuracy and quantity of the data reported. So in that scheme of accuracy, in that scheme of the way we look at data quality, they're really focused in on the accuracy part of it, which is a concern for the APS systems going forward. So thank you, Jody in Illinois. What states are we missing?
Carl, this is Leslie. Alaska also put a chat update in. Alaska's working with the National Committee on Crime and Delinquency to develop a structural decision-making tool. They are currently working with NCCD to include as many NAMRS case component elements as possible. Currently, Alaska APS hand counts or uses custom SQL scripts to try and report as many data points as possible from the case management system.
Okay. And Alabama, we need to circle back.
Yeah, I do apologize. I got a call that just kind of threw me off as you all were talking. But what Alabama is doing in our initial grant, we focused on updating our different data information based on what NAMRS was requiring and putting that into motion with our current policy and procedures. And with our current grant, we are taking that data because we have a QA process in Alabama that is a manual process that's performed by our consultants who we have 67 counties that we monitor, and they have about 14 counties apiece to ensure policy and procedure compliance, but it's more of a manual process. So we're moving that into an electronic process with our dashboards, and that's where NAMRS will come into play to provide us with those different data statistics that we need to ensure that we're improving the outcomes for our APS recipients here in Alabama. Other things that we plan to do with our grant that we received is that with the initial grant money that we received, we were able to look at referrals and services, and we're able to move, we initially put that component into our referral module where our intake is, to look at the services that people were coming in with, so that we weren't duplicating efforts, duplicating services. And now we're rolling that over into our case module so that those services, or those services even that we put in or that we're looking at during the investigation process, can roll over into that case plan if those are still unmet needs for that particular client. Another thing we're doing is looking at out-of-home placements for our vulnerable clients, for safer outcomes and more looking at tracking from that process, as well as we're making changes to our due process and hearing screens. Those are changes that have not been made since our initial system was developed. So we are excited to have this grant and to be able to build off of the data and the statistics that we were able to get based on the NAMRS data components that we were able to build into our system. So that's what Alabama's doing, and I apologize for just kind of being all over the place with the initial discussion when you all called me in.
Fair warning, so that was my fault, and I apologize for that. Leslie, any other states?
We're missing a couple of states, but I'm hesitant to call folks out if they don't want to talk, but I know we have one that had some NAMRS stuff.
This is Brianne from Ohio. Hi, I was trying to connect. Hi, but I couldn't make it, so here I am now. So Ohio, we've made a lot of improvements, and the ACL grant stuff has been awesome. We built from, well, I guess we didn't build it, but we created a case management system for Ohio, and along the way, we've got enhancements and just trying to incorporate, you know, new components in our system. Right now we're working with our IT so we can get the transfer of our data to NAMRS in a real smooth, like, push button kind of scenario. I know with the last enhancements we did an online referral system for Ohio so that the general public can make referrals 24/7. So that's been a work in progress, and it's working great so far, and we're going to continue working with our developers on that stuff. We're also, I know Heidi's policy team's working to work with our counties on like a quality assurance type help. I don't think it's actually quality assurance, but that's also going to help them with putting accurate data in the system so that we can provide NAMRS all the most accurate data for Ohio.
Okay. And the other state want to respond to this question?
This is Jennifer from New Jersey.
Hey, Jennifer.
Hi. Very similar to Heidi from Massachusetts, New Jersey is going from multiple databases to a single cloud-based database, and we've significantly expanded our data elements. So I fully expect we'll have drastic improvements in the quality and the quantity of data. Also, we have, over the past 2 years, we've been submitting the agency component and the key indicator data, but we also hope to submit case component. That's our goal.
So those are great responses. I hear a lot of common themes through there in terms of moving from multiple databases to single databases, to a real focus on trying to improve quality, to getting to where we've got more of those states that are reporting case component data going forward. So, question we wanted to ask y'all, and I don't know that I'm as interested as universal a response here, but I would like for most states to respond to what are some of your actual or anticipated barriers that you're having in terms of improving the quality and quantity of your data. Who would like to go first? I learned my lesson in calling Alabama or anybody.
Carl, this is Heidi. I'll jump in again and just elaborate a little bit on what I had mentioned earlier. The Executive Office of Elder Affairs in Massachusetts and the Disabled Persons Protection Commission, we combine our data for our submission. And it's always been a challenge, and I anticipate that will be an even bigger challenge when we try to combine our case component data, because we may not necessarily be collecting the same information. So I always make the analogy that we're taking apples and oranges and giving you bananas, but it's a challenge to combine our information because we have different definitions, different jurisdictions, different regulations, and it's just challenging to have one submission. So I anticipate that that will be a little bit of a barrier when we try to combine the case component data.
Carl,
yes, this indeed, it will be for you.
Carl, this is Minnesota, and we have the same problem. We have other agencies that have other systems, and it's hard to combine everything into one submission. And that's why I kind of asked if we could have multiple submissions to NAMRS because of this, but it's been difficult.
No. Just like Massachusetts asked too, and we said no.
I know. So now
I worry about the integrity of the data because it's like I said, we're putting different data elements together as one submission, and they may not necessarily mean the same thing, and that's just our struggle.
Yeah. Because we have, even right now, my project manager is online listening to this, and I'm glad she is, because she knows that we're not the only ones asking for these things, that we want to combine different data and put it all in one warehouse, and trying to do that and trying to ask our technical resources to do that has become really costly for our project.
Any, and this is sort of anticipating the last question, but I'll go ahead and ask it. Any lessons learned up to this point in terms of that? Because this is a similar, as you heard, to several states are struggling with. Margie, any lessons learned at this point?
Yeah. I think we should have, and Michelle is on the line. I think we should have done a lot of pre-estimating for the technical resources that we were going to need and the quality assurance resources that we were going to need for combining this data from all these agencies into one, because it is, you know, it's almost doubled what the work is. So We're still trying. I mean, it's still going to happen. It's just going to take longer.
Yeah. Anybody else with a similar barrier before we move on to different types of barriers? Different type of barrier that y'all are running into, another state perhaps.
Carl, we have two in the chat. West Virginia is dealing with accuracy from doing manual counts.
Yeah.
And Utah is looking at the quality versus the quantity and needs measures put in place that ensure the quality and the internal buy-in of the importance of data.
Yeah. And Tracy, obviously we've talked about that some, and that, as I alluded to in my opening remarks, I think that is a real struggle for all of the states, and there seems to be a real trade-off between quantity and quality. That's one of the things that we learned in that gap analysis. So,
Carl, we experienced the same thing in Ohio. It doesn't really matter how we put the data, like we'll make it required and put an unknown, and like they always put unknown, or they just, yep. There just doesn't seem, they don't seem to, you know, we've encouraged them to go back and, hey, once you find out this information, update. They don't update. So I think that's one of the barriers that we've run into.
I will say this makes Oklahoma feel better because we have the same challenge getting all the data fields completed. So we're not alone.
No, and of course they don't like it when you make a lot of required fields, but to get good accurate data, we had to do that on some of the fields just to get the data.
Yep. Anybody with a similar sort of issue or problem? The quality trade-off.
Virginia has the exact same problem. The workers gather the information, but they're not putting it into the case management system. So we are going to be making fields mandated.
Yeah, this is Jen from New Jersey. We're kind of going through that right now as we develop this big system and trying to come up with, you know, with APS, sometimes in the beginning of a case, you don't have all of this information. So, you know, trying to establish various points at which, you know, like by the closure of a case, we hope to have someone's date of birth. Like you should have a date of birth at that point, but you might not have it at the beginning. So it's just difficult to try and gather all of this important information and figure out what's mandated and what's not.
A tip from Minnesota, do not put too many text fields.
Yeah.
No text.
Thank you.
Limit the text fields to what is necessary, and because we had to do way a lot of cleanup.
Thank you.
Any additional barriers?
There are a couple of comments in the chat field along these same lines. Montana is talking about educating on all points of the data and getting the investigators to complete the fields. Illinois is saying they may be one of the states with several unknowns, looking at are the caseworkers not even asking the questions or clients declining to answer. They don't really have a handle on why there's so many unknowns. And then there's a couple of comments talking about the unintended consequences of making changes to your case management systems and the time it takes to get those up and running.
So what would be an example, if y'all don't mind speaking up, what would be an example of an unintended consequence?
Hi, this is Nicole from Virginia. One of the things that we made a quick change was to make sure that when we had a substantiated case, that an alleged perpetrator was identified. So prior to that, someone could make a substantiation but leave the perpetrator blank. So we changed the system, except that the system now makes every single perpetrator identified in that case, you have to make an X next to them when not all of them may be the perpetrator. You could identify, say, three perpetrators were reported, but only one was the actual perpetrator. So we're working on fixing that issue.
Okay. So being mindful of our time, the last question was more focused on solutions and whether there's some specific things that we, the APS TARC, can do to help you with your issues, or sitting here listening to the richness of the conversation, wondering if there's something that you can learn from other states. Any thoughts on those questions? What did you hear today that would be helpful to you?
This is Brianne from Ohio. I do find it very helpful hearing from other states and what they're doing. I'm wondering if more communication could better, like throughout the states that, you know, or even on this call, would be helpful.
So maybe facilitating some discussion along states that are struggling with quantity versus quality lines, or states that are struggling with multiple systems kinds of issues, so that you can at least talk to one another.
That would be great. This is Margie from Minnesota.
Yeah,
this is Jen from New Jersey. I agree. I feel like my state is behind a lot from where a lot of other states are. And just the simple tips, you know, that's very helpful. Thank you.
And I think lessons learned on the kind of the fundamentals of when we're going into a project. I mean, we know the overall project, but some of the things that like our team learned about scoping things out, about estimates, about how much is actually going to be about, you know, the quality assurance, how important is that? What can you limit? I mean, kind of the things that you kind of learn as you go along.
Okay, so maybe we can facilitate some further discussion along those lines through some future webinars or something like that. Andy and Leslie and I will take that back to ACL and have a discussion about that. And we've talked about this idea of communities of practice before with ACL in terms of technical assistance, and this is pointing a little bit along those lines. So it's an area we've thought about some before. I'll tell you, it's not easy to do, but it is very productive when you do it right. So our time is up. I want to thank you very much for your participation. I thought this was a very fruitful conversation. Please don't hesitate to send us additional thoughts. I mean, we all have the experience of, I wish I'd thought to say that in the meeting. So if you have additional thoughts on solutions or better descriptions of your barriers, please send this on the APS TARC and email, and that will help inform our future efforts to better support you. Leslie, any concluding final thoughts?
Yes, just a couple of things. I want you to check out Tracy Lee's comments in our chat line, by the way, about some additional things for question number three, but I'm recognizing our time is up. So I just want to tell everyone, thank you for participating on the grantee meetings. This is our final session. So by the end of this week, we will be sending out an evaluation to the grant contacts for the meeting. And we would appreciate at least want a response from every state. It will be obviously an anonymous evaluation form, but we do need a response from as many states as possible. And we want to thank you for your attention and for attending the grantee sessions. I want to wish everyone a great day. Carl, if you're done, I'm going to end our session.
All right, this was very insightful. Thank you very much for your participation.
Bye-bye, everyone.
Have a good day.
Thank you.
Hi, Leslie.
Bye, Brune.
Yay! Like, we live in the same state.
I know. As soon as COVID's over, okay? As soon as COVID.
I know. You have a great day, Leslie. Talk to you soon.
You too. Will do.